The oceans are the lungs of our planet. They inhale the CO2 that's in our atmosphere and exhale oxygen, pretty much like forests, but on an even bigger scale. They give us the air we breathe, and they're slowing down climate change. But there's a problem. We pump so much CO2 into the air that our oceans can't take it anymore, which makes it more likely that climate change will spiral out of control. But what if there was a way to trick them into breathing in more than they already do? Trick them into taking in so much that we actually reduce the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. So how would this work? Before we explore the solutions, let's define the problem. In 2021, humans released over 30 gigatons of CO2 into the atmosphere. That number is hard to picture, but it's almost 50% more than it was at the start of the Industrial Revolution. The science is clear. We need to get this number down and remove carbon from our atmosphere. Plants, especially trees, are very good at this. That's why everyone loves planting them. They take in around 7.5 billion tons of CO2 each year. But the ocean is even better at it. It can store 20 times the amount of CO2 than plants and soil. The problem is that the ocean is having to take up more and more of it, which throws everything off balance. Not to mention, all that CO2 makes the oceans more acidic and a harder place for living organisms to survive in. That's why people are looking into how to reduce the CO2 in the water, and by doing that, making the ocean absorb more CO2 from the atmosphere. One of the most effective ways to do that is storing it as blue carbon. Blue carbon refers to our marine and coastal ecosystems, because oceans, seagrasses, tidal marshes, and mangroves take in carbon dioxide down to their roots and store them in the sediment below. Coastal environments account for half of what's sequestered in the ocean sediments.
If you compare the Amazon rainforest with a mangrove area, so we can say that between 5 and 10%, 10 times more carbon dioxide is sequestered and stored in the sediments in a mangrove area compared to the forest, terrestrial forest.
This is Maria Claudia Diaz Granados Delgado. She's the Blue Carbon Director at Conservation International. She works with communities, local governments, and organizations to restore coastal ecosystems.
The problem is we have very little amount of these ecosystems in the world, basically, because they have been destroyed. That is a result of the coastal development, for example, or fishing industry as well.
The problem with destroying ecosystems is not only that they're no longer able to take in any more carbon, it's also that the carbon they had stored gets released back into the atmosphere. Delgado has been involved in restoring an 11,000-hectare mangrove forest in the Bay of Cispata on the coast of Colombia. There, communities play an active role in maintaining the forest. Valuable fish species have returned, and ecotourism is providing a means of living. Community members take soil samples to measure how much carbon is being stored in the sediment, the roots, and the foliage, too. Delgado expects the carbon payoff to be big, but knowing just how big will take time. Time we don't have.
The problem with natural systems is while they're incredibly efficient on sort of an energy, on a per unit of energy basis, they're incredibly slow.
This is Gaurav Sant. He's a professor of sustainability at UCLA's Simuli School of Engineering. He's working on speeding things up.
And since time is not on our side, effectively you have to rely on engineering for the simple reason that what engineering is good at is taking things that often happen in nature, so to speak, but speeding them up incredibly.
His idea is to remove the carbon dioxide that's currently in seawater and turn it into the same stuff seashells are made out of to store the CO2. He says this can be done with a device he's developing called a flow reactor. Seawater flows through a mesh with an electrical charge running through it. This causes carbon dioxide to dissolve and combine with the calcium and magnesium that's native in seawater to form limestone and other minerals. The flow reactor spits these hardened rocks back into the ocean, along with the seawater that is now clean of carbon dioxide, making space for the ocean to take up more of it from the atmosphere. but it's still a long way from becoming reality. He and his team are hoping to remove some of the 10 to 20 gigatons of carbon dioxide that scientists say we need to remove annually from the atmosphere by 2050, if it works, because right now things are still in the demo phase.
Carbon management is not a scientific challenge, it's a scaling challenge, right? And it's an economic challenge. So being able to demonstrate that carbon management technologies are accessible, affordable, and scalable is really what we need to do.
Gaurav's team isn't the only one working on sequestering carbon in marine rock. If you've ever walked along a beach, you've walked along the area where this guy thinks we can have the most impact.
Sometimes we like to say the solution here is we just need to bring sand to the beach.
This is Tom Green, the CEO and co-founder of a company called Vesta. Vesta proposes adding a natural carbon-sucking material called olivine onto coastlines to rid the planet of carbon emissions. They estimate we can capture a billion tons of it pretty easily.
We'd need about a quarter of 1% of the area of coastal shelves in order to do that.
Extracting olivine doesn't require chemical processing. It's just dug out of the ground and ground up into a sand. It's found all over the world and is one of the most abundant natural minerals on the planet. When rain falls on olivine, the rock dissolves a little bit and causes a chemical reaction that takes carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. This mixture then gets washed into the ocean where organisms like corals and shellfish use it to make their calcified bodies.
So this is nature's way of turning atmospheric CO2 into rock.
Adding olivine to shorelines helps speed up what's already happening in the oceans. Vesta recently completed their first pilot project on the eastern seaboard in the US, in Southampton on Long Island in New York. Coastal erosion over time meant the community had lost their beach and the local harbor had become nearly unnavigable for ships. They brought in sand to reconstruct the shoreline, and Vesta added ground olivine to it. Now they wait to determine if it'll do what they think it should.
We're measuring everything from an ecological point of view. And then of course, we're measuring carbon removal as well. It's very, very early days, so we don't have any results to report yet. But I can say that we are seeing changes in the seawater that are in line with our expectations.
The fact that olivine is so readily available is part of what makes this a scalable solution too.
Simplicity is important to achieve meaningful scale. And again, these are processes that do not rely on exotic chemistry. They do not rely on exotic materials.
But olivine sand dumping and flow reactors are still in the experimental phase. They promise big gains, but rolling them out to make the impact we need will take time and lots of money. If they don't work as hoped, we'll be right back where we started, but with even more carbon in the atmosphere.
Emissions reductions have to come first, or have to be, you know, we can't just keep emitting and also do carbon dioxide removal at the same time.
So what should we be doing?
It's important for all of us to develop these ideas and try to do something about our planet.
By no means is there a silver bullet, and so we have to rely on a portfolio of solutions.
Olivine dumping, flow reactors, and coastal restoration offer possible solutions to our carbon emissions problem, but they can only do so much. What do you think? Are they worthy endeavors? Let us know in the comments, and subscribe to our channel for new videos every Friday.